Ham Radio Now, episode 125. From the ARRL and TAPR Digital Communications Conference 2013 version from Seattle, Washington, USA, I'm Gary Pierce, KN4AQ. This episode is going to be a talk by Tom McDermott, N5EG, and if you understand the title of this one, GNU Radio Companion, if you know how to pronounce GNU, you're halfway there. GNU Radio Companion Module for Open HPSDR Hermes and Metis, then you are definitely in the audience for this talk. If you don't understand any of that, I'm going to explain a little bit that may help you on your way, and you can watch as much as you can understand, and if you're interested in software-defined radio, this will take you any direction that is useful for you. So here's the deal. TAPR works with another group called HPSDR, High Performance Software-Defined Radio, on designing and making kits available for software-defined radios. They've been doing this for some time, and I've been learning about them as I've covered the DCCs since 2008. And they are not the first in the world, but the first in ham radio to have taken this concept of doing the analog-to-digital conversion as close to the antenna as possible. A little filtering, for them, that's about it. A little filtering and then off into digital domain. A wide swath of the RF spectrum. For them, it's a couple hundred kilohertz to over 60 megahertz. And doing everything else in the digital domain. So they have been working on equipment, receivers, transmitters, and the associated peripherals for some time. In the past year or so, they decided to build a single board and put all that stuff into one board, and that board is called Hermes. The naming conventions at TAPR and HPSDR are a little strange. A lot of Greek stuff. Occasionally, I think they move into Disney territory. I think they've got a Pinocchio somewhere. So they've got a good sense of humor about all this. So the Hermes is a transceiver built on a single board, and it's not pretty. If you're thinking, you know, transceiver, and you're thinking about ICOM or Kenwood or Yaesu or even Flex or Elecraft, no, this is what we're talking about. It's a board. That's the heart of it, this great big FPGA. That's what does all the hard work. And they have some enclosures, and this has actually been built into a sort of a commercial product. You can look it up. But it is at the mostly do-it-yourself end of ham radio. Although I think that they've got a Hermes board that you can buy all built, but it's still a board. You got to put everything else together yourself. So, and the software that has been used to run these things is PowerSDR, something that Flex developed and made open source, and everybody gets to use it. So, if you're going to put one of these together and put it on the air, then you're probably going to be running PowerSDR. Okay, so that's the background. In this talk, what I've been able to glean from it, and I got to admit, I didn't understand everything that the Tom was talking about. What he has done is come up with another way to go into the radio and make things happen. Now, he will say that this is not a replacement for PowerSDR. It's not operational software. But when you're going to get into something like this, if you're going to dig into a software-defined radio at the level of having a Hermes or some of the other more discrete receiver transmitter pieces, there's a pretty good chance you want to learn some things. You want to be able to play. You want to be able to fiddle around with stuff that PowerSDR is not going to let you be able to do. If PowerSDR is just your interface, it's your front end, your graphical user interface to be able to make the radio play and get it on the air. So he has come up with some stuff, working through GNU Radio Companion, that will let you dig into the guts of this software-defined radio. Specifically for what he's doing with this is the digital signal processing, being able to manipulate the signal inside the software. Make it to do some things or play with doing some things. It's very experimental. Again, not operational particularly, nothing you want to put on the air this way, but be able to tinker around, see what you can do, and check and see what the results are. So that's what this talk is all about. again, if you're brand new to all of this, you're probably not going to get very far before it's gone over your head. But if you're seriously interested, then this is one of those talks to learn as much as you can now, go out and learn more. He's got lots of references, and then come back and see how much more you've learned and where this might take you. And if you've reached the point where you can use this stuff, well, more power to you. Go have fun. So we'll get to that talk in just a minute. As usual, I want to thank all the folks that helped me get out to Seattle and record these programs. First of all, the hams who supported the Kickstarter, 115 of you individually, and making up about half of the total amount that we raised, about $6,000 worth. And then our three corporate underwriters, and they are Flex Radio Systems. And I guess this would be a good point to mention that if you're interested in software-defined radio, if you like what it can do, if you like the ability to digitize that great big swath of RF and then work on it totally in the digital domain inside a high-powered computing system of one sort or another, but you don't want to learn all of the blood and guts. If you like the idea and you want to go do it, but building it all yourself and then learning everything possible that goes on inside of it is not your cup of tea. You just want to take advantage of the capabilities and get on the air and play with it. Then Flex is a really good place to go. The 6000 series, which currently consists of the 6500 and 6700, are totally software-defined radios. You can see that we're looking at a little box. There's no knobs, dials, anything on it except a mic connector, a headphone jack, and a connector for a key. Well, I see a couple more buttons on there, but you're not going to go very far with those buttons. You're going to use their new software, Smart SDR, and control the radio from your computer. Now, all of the serious processing is going on inside the Flex radio. They're doing all the hard work. Your computer for the 6000 series is just the graphical user interface. So it can be a pretty, what they call a thin client, small, low-powered computer, even a netbook. Eventually, and they don't have this ready now, but eventually tablets and even smartphones and then control over the internet. They're working on that. That's the kind of stuff that is on the way. So the 6000 series is their top of the line for software-defined radio. They still also got their earlier models, the 3000 and the 1500. Those do their software-defined stuff a couple of analog stages deeper into the system. They do some conversion in analog, and then they go software-defined. And they're still shuttling a lot of the data out of their box and into your computer. So you need a beefier computer. You need something that's going to be able to handle the workload and do the software-defined stuff in your computer. Still very flexible, a lot of capability, very high performance, but not quite up to what the 6000 series is able to do. So once again, if you're interested in software-defined radio, but you just want to be able to get the benefits of it, to be able to play with it and have it do the work for you, then stop by flexradio.com and check out their series of equipment. Our second corporate underwriter is Elecraft. And Elecraft supports TAPR and the efforts because they're also very digital-oriented. This K3 is a software-defined radio, but it does its software-defined stuff inside what looks like a conventional radio. You see all the, you know, the big knobs and the dials and a lot of buttons and stuff. All of that is controlling software inside the radio that is doing all the work of demodulating and doing modes and filtering, stuff like that. All that stuff is done in software in the K3, but it looks like a conventional radio. So that is the kind of thing that appeals to some hams. Some like everything in a graphical user interface. Some like it in a box that you can pick up off the desk, stick under your arm, and carry out into the field and operate for field day or a de-expedition or things like that. If you really want to carry something out in the field, then check out the KX3, which is a totally self-contained HF through 6 meters and 2 meters with an internal module. And batteries go inside. Batteries not included, but batteries can go inside. A 10-watt, totally self-contained, portable HF rig with specifications that rival a standard home HF station. So that's something that is great for taking out backpacking or mountain topping. You could operate it mobile. They've got a 100-watt amplifier that you can add to it. So lots of options for playing with the KX3. So stop by Elecraft.com and check out their growing line of ham radio equipment. They've got lots of other cool stuff as well. And finally, our third corporate contributor, and very apropos for this episode, is TAPR itself. And let me give you a pre-recorded pitch talking about TAPR. TAPR is dedicated to advancing the amateur radio art. They're focused on digital communications in all its forms. And if you're interested in anything digital in amateur radio, you will find like-minded hams to both support and challenge you in TAPR. There are special interest groups and a bunch of specialty mailing lists to keep you in touch with hams who share your niche. You'll also find kits to help you get started building stuff. You can start with simple projects and work your way up to a full high-performance software-defined transceiver. But you need to know that many of the kits are done as limited production runs, just to get projects off the ground. Then TAPR members and their designers move on to the next project. So if something piques your interest, don't wait too long. TAPR sponsors the DCC, of course, along with the ARRL, and they host forums at some of the larger ham fests throughout the year. You can expect a big presence at Dayton with a booth, a forum, and a dinner. They publish their quarterly newsletter, the Packet Status Register. And I love that they've kept the name Packet in that. Yes, Packet is still around, and TAPR keeps their hand in it. But like TAPR itself, the Packet Status Register is now all things digital in amateur radio. Membership in TAPR is $25 a year. That'll get you a discount on some of the kits. And of course, I'm going to point you to their website, TAPR, TAPR.org, for more. Thanks again to TAPR, Flex Radio Systems, Elecraft, and of course you. And now back to Seattle, the ARRL and TAPR Digital Communications Conference, and we will check out Tom McDermott N5EG and his GNU Radio Companion Module for Open HPSDR for the Hermes and Metis. Steve, take it away.
Okay. All right, so now that we've got everybody trained up here, I'd like to introduce Tom McDermott, N5EG. His talk is GNU Radio Companion Module for the Open HPSDR Hermes Metis SDR Radio. Thank you, Tom.
This project got started last year after I acquired a Hermes module and wanted to run some experiments and started writing software in C# and using Microsoft Chart Control, and realizing that every time I made a mistake, I had to go back and rewrite a lot of software. And I went to DCC last year and saw the GNU Radio symposium put on by Tom Rondeau and figured there was no need to reinvent that wheel. So the effort quickly moved to making Hermes and Open HPSDR work under GNU Radio. So I have to say, the views expressed here are my own, not those of my employer, not those of any standards associations and all that kind of stuff. I think in 20 years, that part of the presentation is going to take the first 19 minutes. So the talk is about GNU Radio and GNU Radio Companion, how to integrate HPSDR into GRC. And in this case, that's Hermes and Metis with an Ethernet interface. And it's been tested both with Hermes and with Metis. And then a couple example applications of GNU Radio Companion and HPSDR, and a little bit about where do you find it, how do you install it, a couple of notes about version 3.7, and then some references. There's lots of URLs in the presentation. You don't have to scribble furiously. The presentation's on my webpage, and so if you don't want to write that fast, you can just get it later. So GNU Radio is a library of DSP modules. Some of them are in Python and some are in C++. It contains graphical display and input, file I/O, sound card, audio I/O, network I/O, all bundled into GNU Radio. It does real-time data stream management. The real-time code is usually written in C++ for performance. You can do modules in Python. Typically, you want to do stuff that's not running too fast if you do it in Python. GNU Radio is open source. I've personally run it on Ubuntu 12.04, 12.10, and 13.04. I think it needs version 10 or later of Ubuntu. I think 9 no longer works with it, I'm not sure. There are reports of Windows and Mac versions running, but people on the GNU Radio Reflector have noted some issues, so I've got a couple of links to people who claim to have made it work. I won't make that claim. GNU Radio Companion is a GUI front end for GNU Radio. Basically, what it lets you do is to write real-time DSP via drag and drop without writing code. So you can do real-time DSP and you don't have to write software. It's great for universities because a lot of students use GNU Radio to learn DSP. And rather than get hung up in the intricacies of software and complexities of pointers and threads and things like that, the students can focus on the algorithms and the modules and the interconnection, and they can connect visualization tools to flows and look at what's going on and kind of focus more on the DSP part and a little bit less on the software part. And I think for a lot of students, it makes it easier to get started in DSP. You can quickly make mistakes, you can fix those mistakes, you can see what happens, and you can see what happens when you fix it. HPSDR, so this project started trying to figure out how to get my Hermes to talk to GRC. And I went to Tom's seminar, which is a good seminar, very graphically oriented seminar, opened up GRC, and my description of GNU Radio would be largely undocumented. So the way to describe that is if you ask a question, the response was usually, look at the source code. And there's a lot of source code in GNU Radio. So my best friend became Google, and I would ask a question to Google, and about page 6 of the response would be somebody else who had the same question and found the answer. And that would kind of clear the next stumbling block to go. I found this thing called modtool.py, which is a Python script. And an out-of-tree module in GNU Radio is a module that does not come bundled with GNU Radio. So when you install GNU Radio, you get a lot of tools. And it's fairly easy for people to add a new module to GNU Radio that's not part of the distribution. That module is called an out-of-tree module. And modtool.py is a script that automates a lot of the tedious stuff for you. So it creates skeleton directories, it creates module prototypes, does all the makefile and cmakefile generation. You have to do a little bit of makefile editing, but it's pretty obvious how to do it. You don't really have to understand make. You don't really have to understand cmake to do the edits. They're pretty self-explanatory when you look at it. And then you use cmake and make to actually run the build and install the module into GNU Radio. For this particular module, I took the Google online Python course and then found I didn't need any of it whatsoever. And since I took that course, I think I've managed to completely forget absolutely everything there is to know about Python. Fortunately, I knew C++ already, and so it was a little easier to get going. All the code is written in C++, and that's because most of what's going on is real-time buffer management in trying to talk to Hermes. Hermes sends all of the IQ, receive, and transmit data encapsulated in Ethernet frames, and mixed and merged into those Ethernet frames are the command and control bits to Hermes. What frequency do you want the receivers on? What frequency do you want the transmitter on? Stuff like that. So most of the code is merging command and control in with the IQ data, peeling it back out on the receive side, and doing all of this without blocking threads. GNU Radio, if one thing GNU Radio does not like is for you to block a GNU Radio thread. So it was all written in C++. It's threaded buffer management. And there are callbacks to set and change parameters. It's really not a big project. It's only about 1,000 source lines of code. It uses the GCC toolchain, uses standard Linux sockets and C headers. I mean, this is not real hard to do. And one XML file. And the XML file comes pre-filled in for you by the mod tool generator. You just have to go edit it. Tell it what all the GUI labels are on your GUI. Tell it what the callbacks are and give it some text for the help file for the module. It's pretty straightforward. There's not a lot to it. So what does this software do? The software provides a connection of the Hermes receivers, and right now it supports one or two receivers, cleverly called RX0 and RX1, and it wires up the IQ data from the receivers to GNURadio as sources out 0 and out 1. So GNURadio has connectors on modules that represent data sources and data sinks. And the Hermes transmitter is a sync, so it syncs data from GNURadio and transmits it out over the air. Hermes receiver is a source. It receives data from the air, and it sources those data symbols into GNURadio. Interestingly, the module is full duplex. It will transmit and receive simultaneously. That's because Hermes is a full duplex piece of hardware. It takes control inputs from the GUI, and it figures out where to stuff the control bits into the registers in the Ethernet frames and get them shipped to Hermes. It can set frequencies, turn the attenuator on and off, hit push to talk, tell it how many receivers it has, things like that. It also receives status from Hermes, such as the ADC overload, the FPGA revision indicator. Right now, nothing happens with that. One limitation is it only supports a single Hermes or Metis module at a time. So if you plug multiple Hermes or multiple Metises onto the same network that the PC is on, the first one to answer grabs control. So right now it's kind of one radio per PC. So this is a block diagram of the software and what it does. There's three software modules, Metis.cc. This module came from John Melton's GHPSDR software. It was an early version, and I borrowed it, converted it from C to C++, made a couple of tweaks to it. But it provides a receive socket, the discovery function, and the transmit socket. Discovery is the way that HPSDR finds things. It sends out a magic broadcast packet on the Ethernet, and HPSDR modules, when they hear that, respond, and then the software knows that it's out there and it can figure out what the Ethernet NIP address is. The next part is a proxy, and it's called a proxy because this proxy module represents Hermes, or it represents Metis, to GNURadio. So it kind of translates GNURadio IO things into real radio I thing, so it's a proxy for the module itself. So receive data comes in on socket and it blocks until the entire Ethernet frame is there. The proxy module validates the frame, make sure that it's from a Hermes, it's got all the right packet indicators, it's the right length of a packet, the fields are correct. And it unpacks the IQ data. And it has two modes. If it's one receiver, it knows how to unpack it one way. If Hermes is implemented, it has two receivers in it, it has to unpack it differently because the data is formatted differently. Hermes, I think, right now can support up to five receivers, but the code right now is set up for two. It's not too hard to add more. It then grabs a buffer from a circular pool of received buffers. It has 128 buffers in it. So it unpacks the data and starts stuffing buffers. And as fast as it does that, it returns and unblocks the queue. One thing it also does is to count frames and then schedule the transmitter. Hermes and Metis don't have a way for the transmitter to tell you when it needs another packet or if the transmitter is busy or if it's done. You're expected to pace Ethernet frames to Metis or to Hermes at an equivalent 48K sample rate. And so the way that solved that problem was to look at the frames coming from Hermes, and based upon the number of receivers implemented and the receiver bandwidth, you can in fact mathematically compute how often you should send a transmit frame to exactly match. So if you have one receiver, and you have it set at a 48K sampling rate, you queue one transmit 48K Ethernet packet for each one that you receive. If you have it set for two receivers, 48K, you have to queue one transmit packet for every 1.75 receive frames, and it can get up to about 14 to 1. So this, the logic in here counts these at the right periodicity, it queues a transmit packet. The transmit queue grabs a pre-built packet frame and stuffs it into the transmit socket when it's been queued. The interface to GNURadio is over on the Hermes implementation module, and it has standard interfaces to GNURadio. GNURadio has a couple of well-defined interfaces that you must adhere to so that you can send streams to it and receive streams from it. So this module basically implements the sources and the sinks that are defined by GNURadio. All that's built for you by this module generator. It gives you empty function calls and gives them the right name so that when you write it, it all shows up in the right place. So the GNURadio scheduler talks to the sources and the sinks, and the GNURadio can set parameters. You can go into the GUI and say, what frequency do you want receiver zero on? And those parameters get stuffed into the proxy here so that they can get sent out to the transmit socket. So I mentioned that Hermes is full duplex. There's a push-to-talk control. It does not turn the transmitter on and off. This was a surprise when I first tried it. I figured Hermes would turn the transmitter on and off. All it does is toggle a logic output line on the Hermes module, and presumably you do something like, you know, hook it up to a TR relay or key your amplifier or something like that. But Hermes is actually sending RF even when you have push-to-talk turned off. So I implemented a couple of functions in the module, one of which is a transmit push-to-talk mode, and it's got three possible values. You can deassert that logic output push-to-talk line, you can assert it, or you can set it so that if any transmit IQ symbols in the current frame are non-zero, it will assert the push-to-talk line, and if all of the symbols in the current frame are zero, it will deassert it. So you have those three modes. And this is kind of nice. You can actually burst transmit data into it, and it'll kind of automatically key up, send a transient, and unkey. So it'll do all that sort of automatically if you want to program it that way. There's also two mute controls. Push to talk on mutes the receiver. So when you assert push to talk and you transmit symbols, it'll mute the receiver. And then, of course, you need the corresponding push-to-talk off mutes the transmitter, right? So when you go into receive mode, you actually mute the transmit symbols coming out. And you can turn all those on and off through the GUI to the module. So this is, of course, what a Hermes module looks like. This is an Atlas bus system. John Petrich, W7FU, brought his Atlas bus system down to Southern Oregon about 6 or 8 weeks ago, and we hooked it up and verified that it works. So it's not just Hermes, it actually works with a Metis-based system. You have to strap all the clocks correctly or it doesn't work too well. This is what it looks like in software. In GNURadio, you go up here to HPSDR and you grab Hermes NV and suck it onto the flow graph sheet and you get the module. This is the sync. It's a 48K per second sample rate. And any IQ symbols you stuff in there get mixed up to the transmit frequency that you set on transmit. And if you have it set for two receivers, you have two sources, one for each receiver. If you tell it it's one receiver, then you'll only get one of these connectors instead of two of them on the screen. If you double click this, then you'll get the GUI for the module itself. Down here is all of the help text. A lot of the GNURadio modules in the help text, they'll just say something like, this is an AGC module, set T1, T2, and T3. And that's it. You know, you're sort of left to guess what they mean. And so I tried to go in and tell you what all the valid parameters are and what numeric values you're allowed to put in and what they do. It's really not very hard. It's all in that one XML file where you tell it what all the parameters are. And then up here are the actual settable parameters for the module. You can program the receive and transmit frequencies and set these muting indicators and push-to-talk indicators. You can tell it what Ethernet interface you want it to talk to. It can be ETH0 or it can be any other Ethernet interface on the computer. I added a couple of selectors. The clock selector is the same one that is in HPSDR. And then if you have an Alex board, you can use this extremely unfriendly Alex control, where 32 bits of Alex control have been stolen from three or four different registers and smashed into one 32-bit word. And if you go grab the HPSDR document, you can theoretically control all of that. We did that because by programming the hex value, we were able to get Metis to work by setting the right clock selectors in there. And so it's not friendly, but it is extremely flexible, so it has a kind of a value there. So some of the applications. GNU Radio Companion, my description of it would be it's a software breadboard. You can grab DSP modules, drag them onto the screen, wire them up, just sort of like you used to do with hardware, where you'd get function blocks and mixers and amplifiers and things and put them on a breadboard and wire them up. You do this, except you do it in software, and it takes you 10 seconds instead of a couple of hours. You don't write code. You just grab a mixer, you grab a frequency source, a couple of clicks, and they're wired together, and you are DSPing. So it's good for learning. It's good for prototyping experimental setups, lab tests, DSP experiments, data capture and analysis, even what I would call casual operation. But it's not good for building a replacement for PowerSDR or CUSDR. The control widgets are really very rudimentary by comparison to a full operational software. So if you want to learn DSP, this is a relatively painless way to do it, because you focus on DSP rather than focusing on writing code. GRC has a lot of graphical display capabilities, and if you're trying to debug something, you can grab a spectrum analyzer and tie it into a node in the middle of the radio, and in about 10 seconds you can be watching what's going on and scratching your head as to what's happening. Go change a parameter value and watch things change. You can kind of do that about as fast as it takes to talk about it. GNU Radio has a transient generation and capture capability, and I'll talk about that a little bit later. That's something that really doesn't exist in many of the SDR software packages, and for experimental reasons, there's a lot of value in that capability. It has Ethernet network I/O. It's not only talking Ethernet to Hermes from GNU Radio, but you can also instantiate other Ethernet functions as sources and sinks within GNU Radio. For example, UDP or TCP clients or servers, you can wire up a TCP sync and tell it it's a server, and then somewhere else on the internet, you can log into that server and grab that IQ data stream from that server. And you can tell GNU Radio what port you want it to be on and things like that. So you can essentially remote the data streams that either come out of Hermes or come out of things that have been processed after they've come out of Hermes and make that accessible over a network. 3.7 also has an XML RPC. That's the old name. It's called SOAP today. Essentially a fairly brief XML that lets you get into all of the parameters on the Hermes module, and you can set the frequencies remotely over the network through that socket, and so you can go in and program all of that stuff. So I think you could probably build a remote server with in about a minute without writing any code. You just connect all the sockets up, wire them, tell you what it wants, and you've got a remote network server without writing code. So let's look at a couple applications. One is high-resolution frequency measurement. I wanted to go look and see how far off frequency WWV was. And so first thing I did was take off the 10 megahertz clock and apply an external frequency standard. I have a GPSDO, so I hooked that up and set the receive frequency to some precise small offset around 1 hertz. You can't make it exact. One of the things you have to factor in is that the FPGA on HPSDR is a 32-bit phase accumulator, and so there will be some slight frequency error that's in the range of plus or minus 0.02 hertz, but you can compute exactly what that error is. A good reference, 15.0 megahertz, it turns out all the errors exactly cancel and the NCO is dead on at 15.0. At 10.0, it's off about 0.015 or something like that. So, but you can do the math and figure out what that is. So it needs to be a precisely known small offset, but in the neighborhood of a hertz or so. Then use a narrow low-pass filter with a very high decimation rate to create a low sample rate complex output stream, and then go display that as an FFT or time sequence or constellation. Dump it to a file for long-term post-processing if you want. In GNURadio, it's very easy just to wire up a file as a sync, and then all the IQ samples go to the file. It goes a WAV file, it goes binary file. There's a couple of different options in GNURadio, but it's real quick to do. And so if you dump a low sample rate stream, you can look at it for several hours worth of time, and then do some fairly long duration processing if you're trying to look at things like that. It's fairly clean with a well-behaved unknown, and if you're on the West Coast where WWV and WWVH are about the same signal strength, then it's really messy. So this is the flow graph for doing that. We have Hermes, and since we don't want the transmitter to transmit anything, we just hook up a constant zero and it won't send anything. One of the things GNURadio requires is that all inputs and all outputs have to be hooked to something. If you don't, it won't run. You take the output and we send one branch to a low pass filter here, and that low pass filter in this case is about 10 kilohertz cutoff, and it decimates in this case by a factor of 8. So we're running the receiver here at 384K sample rate and decimate it down to 48K, extract the magnitude, take out the DC component and run it to the audio sync. The audio sync is the sound card on your computer. And so what that means is while we're doing all the data taking, we can actually listen to WWV and hear what it sounds like. At the same time, we send that sample stream to a low-pass filter. In this case, it's a 20 hertz bandwidth low-pass filter that then decimates by 8,000. So it brings the sample rate down to 48 samples per second. We throw that into a GUI sync, and we also send that sample rate to a file sync. So we record that series of IQ samples at 48 samples per second for however long we want to a file, and we can look at it on the GUI and kind of, so we got three syncs going simultaneously, the sound card, a file, and a GUI widget. Didn't take very long to wire this all together. This is, you know, kind of a 5-minute exercise. This is what it looks like in the GUI. So here's the IQ stream coming out, and you can see it's not quite 1 hertz coming out of the baseband, and that's because when I captured this screenshot, I didn't actually have my GPSDO hooked up. I was using the onboard oscillator, and it's not quite that accurate. But you can see I and Q, and how if you process that for a long time, you can watch phase slowly come and go. And here you can see fading, you can see the phase changing state as WWVH kind of goes out and WWV comes in, and they have different path lengths and all kinds of stuff going on. You can look at it as a constellation, the IQ. Ideally, this would be a circle of unity magnitude, and it would be rolling around here at about 1 hertz. And this just shows you when you have two things in there, it's kind of really messy. Another application, this is a single sideband, a single signal SSB receiver. So what this does is to uses the phasing method. We take the Hermes output. I've got two receivers going. And since you have to hook something to everything, I just set receiver zero to the null sync, which kind of does what you think it would do. And then take the other output and put it into a GUI sync and then bandpass filter. And the bandpass filter in this case goes from 200 hertz to 3 kilohertz. And of course, that gets you the upper and the lower sideband. The bandpass filter can't discriminate negative frequency from positive frequency. So you take the output and you run it into Hilbert transforms. GNURadio kind of cheated a little bit. complex to float just peels the I and the Q out. What the reason that Hilbert has a complex output, which is blue as opposed to float input, is that it gives you the Hilbert transformed signal on the real output, and it gives you the non-Hilbert transform but matching time delayed signal on the imaginary output, so that you get the non-transformed and the transformed time aligned, which is extremely convenient for doing any kind of DSP. So you take the I and the Q parts of those, and then you can add and subtract the various flavors of those. There's a couple of complex multiplies, and there's a GUI widget up here called sideband, and you program sideband so that one of these multipliers multiplies by plus one and one by minus one, and they flip when you flip the sideband. And so that causes the upper sideband or the lower sideband to cancel out. And then you run that into an AGC, and you go run it out to an audio sync. I set up the audio sync for two channels, so one goes to left and the other goes to right, and it gives you some interesting audible effects. So when you run it, this is what you get during the runtime. All of those GUI widgets are these things up here. You can turn the preamp on and off, and you can set the push-to-talk controls. Here's the FFT going, and you can see we're listening right about here. You can tell it to display the RF frequency. So what it does is it adds the baseband frequency and the NCO for the receiver channel together, so you can get a display kind of at the RF frequency. Turn on the peak detector. You can average this. You can say how big you want the FFT window to be. So it's, you know, it's just kind of all drop downs that you do in real time. There's some sliders for setting the receive zero, the transmit frequency, and receive one. So it's a GUI. No one's going to confuse this with CUSDR. It's functional. You can carry on a QSO, but really that's not what GNU Radio is optimized for. The console window is at the bottom of the GNU Radio screen, and so the Hermes module writes text to that console to tell you what's happening. First thing it does is tell you it's looking for the card and what interface it's looking on. It tells you, it just goes and enumerates all the interfaces on your PC for you in case you don't know what they are. It tells you its address, and then once it finds a Metis out there, it answers back with the Ethernet MAC address and the IP address of what it got. This is very handy for debugging. If these two lines don't ever come back, you know the problem is that it didn't find your Metis device out there. And so instead of you scratching your head, why is it not working, you know instantly it just didn't find the device in discovery. One of the things that it does is it keeps very careful count of all of the packets. Hermes sequence numbers every Ethernet packet. And so the software checks for any skips in the sequence numbering and keeps track of all of those. And it keeps track of all of the internal buffers. And if it lost any frames, or if there were any corrupt frames or any skipped sequence numbers in the buffers. And when you exit it, it tells you how many zero lost received buffers, a total of 302,000 received packets. Zero transmit buffers lost, how many transmit packets, how many frames had something wrong with them, how many sequence numbers got skipped. The reason that's useful is if you're going to do a multi-hour capture of a data file, and for example, you want to do time analysis, if you were to lose a packet and not put it in the file, it would really confuse your time analysis software. So this way, by knowing that there were no lost frames, you know that you didn't have any phase skips in that output file. So it's kind of useful for stuff like that. GNU Radio does not allow flow graph loops. So if you have a module and its output goes to a loop and that goes back to an input, you have a flow graph loop and it will not run. So one of the things, originally I had two inputs on the Hermes. One of the inputs was the transmit IQ symbol, and the other input was the audio amplifier on the Hermes module. It's got a Class D audio PA, and you can hook a speaker to it. But the problem is anything you try to receive from Hermes would have to go back to that audio input, and you have a flow graph loop. So it's commented out of the code. The solution to that problem is to write Hermes so that the sync is one module in Hermes and the source is a different module, and then you have to have a common control that's invisible in the background. And my view was the utility and the effort required to do that probably didn't justify the work for doing it. So right now it's not that way. It's all one module. To install the software, you install GNURadio by building from source. There's a one-lined script where it gets the build GNURadio, makes it executable, and runs it. There's instructions on the TAPR SVN site on how to install it. The script, if you just run it by itself, it'll install 3.6.5.1, which is the last 3.6 version, or you can give it in some switches and it'll install 3.7.get. Git for the latest version. It also loads all the dependencies and tools needed. I have a quad core i7, it runs in under an hour on that. I have a 1991 vintage machine, and it only takes 8 or 9 hours to build on that. So once you get it up and building, you've got GCC, you've got AutoMake and AutoConfig, you've got CMake, you've got all the tools, they're there. You can then go to the TAPR SVN, download the Hermes-Metis source, and then do the build. The build's pretty easy. It's only 4 or 5 lines. And it's all the documentation is on the TAPR SVN as to how to do it. Notes on GNURadio 3.7. It came out, about 6 weeks ago, maybe? 8 weeks ago? Tom Rondeau last year at DCC said that 3.7 would be widely breaking. And I'm here to tell you, he did not lie. So it broke almost everything that I've run into. So there are now 2 branches of Hermes Metis software on the TAPR SVN. There's a 3.6 branch and a 3.7 branch. Suck down the branch that is the same as the branch of GNURadio that you're building. Furthermore, GNURadio flow graphs are now version dependent, and they never were before, because a lot of the filter modules got moved to a different namespace and they don't work in the wrong version. So your flow graphs are also now tied to the version that you run. There are some exceptions to that. There will be some that work. There's a lot of modules that have not yet been ported to 3.7. There are a lot of analysis tools that are not yet ported to 3.7. And the GNURadio reflector has a lot of messages every day about people trying to convert their tools from 3.6 to 3.7 and going through the process. 3.7 had a few installed and config bugs. They pushed out 3.7.1 to fix some CMake problems, but it caused a couple new CMake problems, and so there's, I think, a fix scheduled for 3.7.2. So basically, GRC 3.6 is stable. There's a lot of support for it. 3.7 is rapidly evolving. Where to find it? It's at the TAPR SVN. You don't have to write down URLs, just grab the presentation from the web page. Before you install 3.7, you have to manually remove any previous GNURadio stuff. So I wrote a script and put it on the website that will go, just run. It's a bash script, just go run it and it'll take all that old stuff off of your system. And this is the 3.6 branch and the 3.7 branch, and you can see there's lots of PDFs on how to go do the builds and how to install stuff. The GNURadio development team has, I think, been pretty responsive to problem reports. They have a bug tracker system. You can go into it and look at the issues. They have a mailing list, they're pushing out fixes pretty much in real time, so they're doing a good job keeping up with them. And periodically, they'll pull all the fixes into a dot release and go ahead and issue that release. GNURadio is also available for the RTL 2832-based USB DVB-T dongles, FunCube dongle. Of course, Edis Research has got a whole ton of stuff. Scotty's SDR stick from Zephyr works. He has an HF1 and an HF2. Interestingly, the HF1 has a 384K compatible Hermes mode and actually talks to the Hermes block as well as to the SDR stick block. And it's possible to port other radios that have USB or Ethernet interfaces with integrated IQ data. So ask around at DCC. It seems like GNURadio is starting to get critical mass in what's supported under GNU Radio. And so it kind of starting to see lots and lots of activity. There's 50 emails a day on the GNU Radio reflector, and there's a lot of stuff going on. So this presentation's at tapper.org, /N5EG. The GNU Radio main page is GNURadio.org. The Tapper Subversion repository, which has got the Hermes-Metis code and bunches of instructions, is at svn.tapper.org. There's a GNU Radio mail list. If you sign up for it, be prepared for a lot of email. I've not tested it, but here's the URL of a message on the reflector about someone who has installed GNU Radio 3.7 using a package called MacPorts that will let it run on Mac. And another one where a gentleman has installed GNU Radio 3.6 on Windows X64 device. And I'd like to thank John Petrich, particularly W7FU, who gave a lot of comments and suggestions on it, brought down his Atlas Metis system to Southern Oregon so we could hook it up and verify that all this stuff works, and who brought a ton of stuff and set it up in the demo room, did all the posters, and brought the PC with it on it. So it's been real very, very helpful, and John has tremendous amount of patience explaining GNU Radio to people, so that's particularly helpful. So that's it in a nutshell.
Have you designed the flexibility to handle some of the other features of Hermes? Because you're right, you say I have only two receivers, but it could support the protocol, so it's up to seven, at least until the next protocol comes out. Yeah. And also, it can go up to 384 kilohertz wide. What if you get going to come up with a new version that'll support those, or?
Yeah, the current version supports 384K.
Okay.
So it'll support 48, 96, 192, and 384. And I think Phil has been working on some faster ones than that, but it's not out. Right. And the documentation for how to change rates on some of the higher modes are not out yet. Right now, it just handles two receivers. I think Hermes, the biggest FPGA load is currently at five receivers, and it's something to consider. It's not that difficult to put in. It's been down on the priority list, right, as getting rid of other bugs right now.
I just want to point out a nifty trick in GNU Radio. On your single sideband flow graph, you can actually get the bandpass filter to give you just the positive or just the negative frequencies if you configure it to use complex taps.
Okay.
Which,
yeah, just the stock one.
Save you some work.
Okay. There's so much stuff in GNU Radio. Yeah. It's hard. Nobody knows, I think, everything that's in there.
Ron Dow does. Maybe. Yeah. Any other questions? Thank you very much, Tom.